Good morning and welcome to Travis Baptist Church this morning, and welcome to those that are listening to later online. Let's go ahead and stand and we'll get started with singing, Come Into His Presence.
Come into His presence with thanksgiving in your heart. And give Him praise. Come into His presence with thanksgiving in your heart. Your voice is raised, your voice is raised. Give glory and honor and power unto Him. Jesus, name above all names. Presence with thanksgiving in your heart, your praise and give Him praise. Come into His presence with thanksgiving in your heart, your voice is raised, your voice is raised. Give glory and honor and power unto Him. The name above all names.
Amen. Today's scripture reading is from 2 Peter 3:15-16. Consider that the long-suffering of our Lord is salvation, as also our beloved brother Paul, according to the wisdom given to him, has written to you. Which untaught and unstable people twist to their own destruction.
Thank you for that. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this time to come together and be in your house as we connect with one another, with fellow believers, that we are encouraged to know the truth, that we speak truth among each other, but embolden us that we speak truth beyond just those with who we have great connections with. We ask that you use us to go out into the community, to our places of work, our places of the stores, go out into the public, and we speak the truth boldly and without any apology, because we know that we stand for the truth and you are a God of justice. And we ask that you work on our lives, that we be good witnesses for you. In your name we pray. Amen. Well, good morning. This is a day that I get to lead the church service. Thank you for letting me do that. I really appreciate it. The pastor is out of town today. Hopefully he's getting some much needed rest. We know that he's worked a hectic schedule for the past couple of years, and so hopefully he's getting a nice break. As far as we go, that we are definitely going to be keeping busy. We've got Vacation Bible School coming up. We've got the meeting that's going to be coming up on the Vacation Bible School is from July 19th to the 23rd, and our next work day is scheduled for May 15th. And we have another meeting on May 17th. For anyone that's interested to help out with Vacation Bible School, please show up and participate. There's lots that can be done as we go use this opportunity to evangelize to the community. This is a great opportunity for children to come and learn about Scripture, to learn about Travis Baptist Church, and understand why we have such a loving relationship with our members here. We also have coming up is this summer is a youth camp. We've got Alto Frio that the youth will be going to. That will be the week before Vacation Bible School, so it's July 12th through the 16th. just before Vacation Bible School. If you know of a middle or high school student who is interested to be around other churches and have a summer camp full of fun and learning the gospel, the good news of Jesus, have them plug in. We'd love to have them. We certainly have several bunks available that are reserved, and so if you know someone who's interested, please let us know. What else? We've got Mother's Day coming up in a couple of weeks, and Deacon's meeting coming up on the 16th. Anything else that we should mention? Okay, so Wednesday, April 28th, is that right? Wednesday, April 28th at 11:30 a.m., there's going to be a card signing at the Millers. So we would like anyone that's interested to participate in that to show up. Anything else that I'm missing out on? I think we got the announcements. Good. So we want to welcome our guests at this time. We are glad to have new faces come around here. We are open to the community. We want our neighbors to come in and enjoy this experience with us. We've got a lot of loving people in this church family. I'm glad to know them, and I hope that the community will get to know them much better also. And we're gonna welcome each other, but before we do, for anyone who is visiting or anyone who needs to update their information with the church office, we have this flap on the bulletin that hopefully you've grabbed on the way in, that you can provide updated information or new information to us and drop that in the offering plate. We've got the offering plates on the periphery of the church sanctuary. So at this time, let's go ahead and stand up and we'll welcome each other into the house.
We make it back to our places, we will continue to stand. Join me in singing, Give Thanks.
To the Holy Amen. Jesus Christ, His Son, give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ.
At this time, the children may be excused to head on up to Children's Church. And as they head up, the rest of us will sing, "They'll Know We Are Christians by Our Love."
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord, we are one. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in our land. By our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. And we'll guard each one's dignity and save each one's pride. And they'll know Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. All praise to the Father, from whom all things come, and all praise to Christ Jesus, His only Son, and all praise to the Spirit who makes us one. And they'll know Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Please be seated. This is a time of prayer. We want to take a time to pray as a family. Prayer is a very important component throughout Scripture, throughout Christian living. Our experience focuses on prayer, and this is a world desperately in need of prayer. As we look through the news cycles and see the stories, the horrors that come across the headlines, and we can see it within our own lives, there's a lot of suffering in the community. There's a lot of people who are suffering through personal tragedy. But we have hope for a better future, and the way we get there includes the spiritual discipline of prayer. So we're going to have our deacons up at the front. If you want to come forward and participate in the prayer, otherwise stay where you are and pray, but let's pray as a family.
Father, we come before you this morning with desires in our heart for our lives and the things that we have faced in the last year. We try and find sense with it. Lord, I asked us not to worry about the things that have passed and the goodness of your love for us as a child of God. Lord, let us look into the present and into the future. What will you have us do? We speak of trying to change the world and the nation through prayer, but Lord, it all starts right here. Within ourselves, what are we going to do? We have prayed for rest. And we forgot about other things in which you require of us. Service, dedication, obedience, praise, thanksgiving. Lord, right now I ask that you touch us in this building, that we may be able to build up a community. Build up a community of like-minded believers that are willing to share and grow relationships with one another. Let us unite in you, Lord. Let us be one another in your presence. Lord, for our soldiers and sailors and Marines who are out protecting us and putting themselves in harm's way, I ask that you watch over them as well as their families while they are drawn apart. For our first responders and those who are on the front lines helping us with our safety and protection, Lord, I ask that you be with them today. Watch over them and protect them. Lord, we have members in this church who are sick in the hospitals. And Lord, I ask right now that you be with the doctors and the specialists to guide their hands and their minds to be able to help in healing and the process of rehabilitation. Lord, I ask that you be with Pastor today He and his family, as they are journeying out to visit other relatives, Lord, that you place the angels around them and protect them. Lord, be with us this day as we come into your house to worship. Let us realize that church is not the building in which we sit in, but the fellowship and uniting of the brothers and sisters that love you and have given you their hearts and lives. Lord, right now, I just thank you. I thank you for the blessings that you have given us. Those that sometimes we don't even see. And it is you. But Lord, I pray that your will be done, that your plan is fulfilled. Help us this day. Be with this congregation. As we hear your word, let the Holy Spirit dwell in this place. Let us feel the presence of you today. Be with Kirk. Watch over him and protect him, Lord. Guide him and keep him. As we go away from this place today, I ask you, let us let our light shine so that people will know that we are Christians by our love. I say these things in the sweet name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
We often get questions about, what does God want me to do? Where does he want me to go? What is his purpose for me in life? And, you know, so many answers are found straight out of the book that he has given us, the words of life that he has put down on page. Yes, they were written by man, but inspired by his Holy Spirit to be written. And I don't know of a single question out there that isn't answered by the Bible. So we have a wonderful book that we would just read and believe, how many problems would go away? Sing with me, Wonderful Words of Life.
Sing them over again to me, wonderful words of life. Let me more of the beauty see, wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty, teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Christ the Blessed One gives to all wonderful words of life. Sinnerless to the loving call, wonderful words of life. Also freely given, wooing us to heaven. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Sweetly echo the gospel call, wonderful words of life. Offer pardon and peace to all, wonderful words of life. Jesus, only Savior, sanctified forever. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life.
Let's go ahead and stand at this time for our offertory prayer. our offertory hymn. If you haven't dropped your offering or your communication cards in the offering plates, feel free at this time to jump out in the aisles and do that at this time. We do have our offering plates all around the sanctuary as we sing Thy Word. God, we just thank you for this time that we can gather together, Lord. We thank you for the words that you've written down on page for us to read. Words of life, words that cause movement. I don't know anybody, Lord, that has able to read your word and not had a reaction. I pray, Lord, that the reaction that we feel today is a movement towards you, that it's your will that we seek, your guidance, your love. And I pray, Lord, that as Kirk comes up here and speaks your word, that you speak through him. Use him as your mouthpiece. And I pray, Lord, that our hearts and minds may be open to your will. Thank you, Lord, for this time that we have to give back to you a portion of what you have given us. And I pray, Lord, that you take our meager offerings and just multiply it, that we are able to reach not only this community, but throughout this country and this world, Lord, that a passion for you may be sparked. I ask these things in your name, O Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
All right, amen. Well, today is April 25th, 2021. My name is Kirk Stowers. This is Travis Baptist Church. Welcome. I'm glad to be here. I hope you are too. It's always good to be in God's home. Michio Kaku just had a book released about 2 weeks ago. It's called The God Equation. And I read in it something that was very interesting last night. He wrote in there about Albert Einstein's secretary. Her name is Helen Dukas. And Miss Dukas had explained that Professor Einstein was overwhelmed with mail asking for his take on the meaning of life and whether or not God exists. This was something that lots of people overwhelmingly had wrote into him about. Professor Einstein did write out his thoughts in a letter just before his death, and in 2018, this, what is called the God Letter, sold at auction for $2.9 million. It exceeded the auction house expectations, and this illustrates a point that people are looking for answers. We're all searching for the truth, where we're not going to be deceived. We know that we live in a world that is full of people that the young people call fake. They may say that their school is toxic. We say that we live in a toxic work environment, that we're surrounded by people who are deceptive for their own benefit. So how can we trust anything? Well, that's what today's message is all about, that we can focus on the scriptures as we just sung. That comes from Psalm 119, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." So if you're able to stand, we're going to be reading out of 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 14 through 17. And if you use the Bible that's in front of you in the pew, that can be found on page 1057. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 14 through 17, and I'm reading out of the New King James Version. "But you must continue in the things which you have learned and been assured of, knowing from whom you have learned them, and that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. All Scriptures is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work." Lord, we thank you for this time to come together and learn a little bit more about your word, that you have absolutely spoken directly to us in writing. This is something that we take to our heart, that we, as we digest this information, that we understand the message you intend for us to have, because we understand that by reading the scriptures, you command us not just to keep it to ourselves, but to share it with the world. A world that is full of people who are deceptive, a world that is full of dishonest people that exploit others for their own gain, but we can trust your scripture, your word, and that we speak the truth to others so that they themselves can benefit with a relationship with you. We ask these things in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. And you may be seated. So the message that I have today, I'm going to be highlighting four particular points from this passage from 2 Timothy chapter 3. These four points I'm going to overlay with some Baptist distinctives. These are from a theologian. His name is Alva Harvey. I think I have his name. Alva Harvey, that he lived in the 19th century. Whoops, I went too fast. Alva Harvey, he was an American theologian and educator. He lived from 1820 to 1903, and I'm going to overlay four principles that make the Baptist faith distinctive, and we get that from Scripture, and we get it from this right here. I'm also going to even further overlay another component. The Travis Baptist youth have been in Sunday school learning about scriptures, and we have been going over Dr. Michael Kruger's book, The Question of Canon. And this is where Dr. Kruger outlines the case of why we can trust the scriptures. So the problem of why that case needs to be made is because not everyone trusts the scriptures. So in the 20th century particularly, there has been a lot of scrutiny to the scriptures. As a matter of fact, 2 Timothy, 1 Timothy, and Titus, the majority of scholars, academic scholars, the majority believe these were not written by Paul, that they did not appear until generations after Paul's death. And when I say a majority, my professors, Luke Timothy Johnson, Daniel Wallace, me, Michael Kruger, basically those are the only ones that I know that are fundamentalists to accept this as Paul. All the other books that I find written after 1900, they go with the assumption that these particular sections of the Bible were not written by who they say that they are. The leading scholar that we've been focusing on is Dr. Bart Ehrman, a very competent textual person who criticizes. He's a scholar that he explains that you realize we don't have original manuscripts of the Bible. As a matter of fact, he says, we don't even have copies of the original manuscripts. We do not even have copies of the original manuscripts. We don't even have copies of copies. That the copies that we do have appear generations later. Archaeological evidence has been uncovered where there are a lot of books of the Bible that are not included, that they were once included by some sections of Christianity, but are not present today. Dr. Ehrman explains about how, like, the Catholic Bible includes what we call the Apocrypha, which have, like, certain chapters of Esther and then whole books that they include in their canon, but we as Protestants do not include. Well, archaeological digs have found these letters, the Gospel of Thomas being the most famous one, but the Gospel of Peter, the Gospel of Judas, the Gospel of Mary. There's a whole host of others they keep finding in these archaeological finds. And why were these books not included? Dr. Ehrman says that many of them we can wholeheartedly, no doubt, demonstrate they are forgeries. Dr. Ehrman continues on to say, some of the forgeries, though, have found it into our Bible. And he points to the pastoral epistles, which are Titus, 1 and 2 Timothy. He also identifies 1 and 2 Peter because, as he cites in Acts 4:13, that it states that Peter was illiterate. Also, if you look in the book of Romans, that chapter 16, verse 22, it identifies the writer as Tertius, not Paul. And so this may cause some confusion. So how can we trust when we have all this, all these evidences of dishonest people trying to lead people into some type of exploitation where they, you know, they can be controlled for the deceiver's own benefit? That's why Dr. Kruger has made it so important, and why we have made it important for the youth to know the truth, that I am convinced that the scriptures are the absolute word of God and we can trust it. And so that is the problem that we wrestle with as we go through this. But for our Baptist distinctives, according to Alva Havi, first one, Baptists begin with the Bible to discover proper Christian belief and practice. So the we looked at some definitions of how you identify the canon. And in verse 14, we understand that you have learned from God. As we go back to the text in verse 14, but you must continue in the things which you have learned and been assured of, knowing from whom you have learned them. You learned them from God. We understand that there is a metaphysical world, that that is not our imagination. As a matter of fact, you could say our imagination is evidence that there is a God, that there is the thought. If you remember from your philosophy class, from the idea of I think, therefore I am. If you've ever heard that, I think, therefore I am, it's because that's the idea that a thought exists. We know a thought exists, but it doesn't. You can't see it. You can't weigh it. You can't measure it. It takes up no space. This is the idea of René Descartes. He said, I think, therefore I am. You can't disprove that the idea exists. Everyone has their own individual idea, but where is that kept? How do you know that someone else has thoughts? Because we act on our thoughts. And that is something that is, that the science cannot measure. And so, knowing that God exists based on that particular evidence, and we understand that we learn from God, do we accept someone's oral testimony? That is a bit of data. If someone tells you something, now for experienced police officers, you know that not everyone is honest. As a matter of fact, if you show up someplace and you want to get the story, what people say, you can, maybe it's reliable, maybe not. Thank goodness for the new technology. We have the body-worn cameras, we have cameras in the cars, and we get things recorded because, like some of us that before the time of the cameras, trying to get someone's story, and then they contradict, oh, I didn't say that. And they say, well, no, you misunderstood me, or I didn't say, and you, I know what you said, I heard you, but they always claim mistake. When it's on video, we've got you locked into a statement. The old way was to get people to write it down, but when you show up to scenes dealing with people, good luck getting it in writing. It's something that's it's a real chore. But thank goodness we can get it on record, and that's why it's so important not only to get it on video recording, because if you hear the audio, you may mishear things, you may things can possibly interfere with that. And so with the videos for courtroom presentation, there is going to be a written transcript with that. Writing is so crucial because you take your time, and when it's locked into a statement in writing, you can't say, oh, I didn't say that or something like that. It's, you sign your name to it, you say, that's exactly what I mean, so that years from now, this is what you said then. Do you still believe that? Or, you know, if something changes, if something is deceptive, you're locked into that statement. So with the canon, that's why it's so important, we have it written down. The Bible is one of the only documents that I can think of that has never been altered. We have a complete, closed, final list of books. We have the 66 books, we've got the 27 in the New Testament, 39 in the Old Testament. They have been written down thousands of years ago, under scrutiny for several thousand years, and it has gone unchanged. So we understand that it is not only just a complete final list of books, but it is used by believers as scripture. We also believe the ontological point, which is that it is given by God. We trust it because it was given by God. The second point of Al-Wahhabi's Baptist distinctives, Baptists believe in personal accountability to God in all religious matters. In verse 15, and that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. Scriptures make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Early Christians believed Jesus finished the final story. That's an important point to understand, that the Old Testament provided the picture of where we are as people. Read through the Old Testament and you understand that we need a Savior. It's like having two acts of a three-act play, and that's the way the early Christians believed it, that the New Testament was finally the close of the story, that finally we have the climax and we have the eucatastrophe, as C.S. Lewis calls it. The eucatastrophe is when there is a impossible condition that seemingly cannot be overcome, but then the hero comes in and saves the day. That is called the eucatastrophe by C.S. Lewis. And that's the way the early believers saw the New Testament, that this finished the story of the Old Testament. Jesus inaugurated a new covenant from early on, when Moses came down and he had the Ten Commandments, that this is put in writing, that we are going to write down God's word. This is what God demands of us. We are going to have an agreement with God, which is unique to Christianity. No other religion on the planet has any kind of a covenant, according to Walter Eichrote, the German theologian, this is a covenantal God. He makes promises with his people, with his creation. And so that is put in writing. Like any contract that you would endeavor on, if you go buy a house or you go buy a car or do anything that is a significant aspect of your life, it's going to be in writing. If you're going to build a house, that's going to be in writing. Any kind of a major endeavor, God has made it no different, that he has it written down. And so you hold up your end of the bargain, because he's definitely holding up his end of the bargain. And so this word has been shared by apostles, that these apostles were empowered by authority from God. So the third distinctive that we're going to get to is that Baptists believe salvation depends on your response to God's love and grace. In verse 16, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. I have heard, in my personal experience, I've heard well-meaning people say that those who wrote the Bible, many of them did not even know they were writing scripture. That these letters that Paul wrote, or that Peter wrote, or that John wrote, that they were writing letters, but they did not know that they were scripture. I don't know if you've ever heard that, but that is not true. That is absolutely 100% not true. We just did our scripture reading, which was in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 15 through 16, where Peter refers to Paul's letters as scripture. And going back on to Dr. Ehrman's argument that Romans was actually written by Tertius, as you can look it up in your own Bible, chapter 16, verse 22, this was a collaborative effort. This was like when kings would write to dignitaries or to other people in the royal court. These were official documents. They were intended to be shared. So when Paul wrote his letters to Titus or to Philemon or to Timothy, in the second Timothy, you can see that it's very personal. He's asking Timothy to come visit him. This is a time where Paul, in earlier chapters, in chapter 1, the first chapter, he explains that he's in prison. And we believe that, as we look at it as a historical document, that we understand that he was in prison in Rome, and that this is towards the end of his life. He's about to be executed. But he writes to Timothy, asking for him to come visit, and some personal things. There is some personal aspects about it, but it is written as an official document that's with the intention that people are looking over his shoulder, that the church is looking over Timothy's shoulder as this letter is read. It is intended as an official document. This is like a proclamation from the king, that this is something that is to his people and that it is intended to be accepted as a community, not just for individuals. So they knew that what they were writing was scripture. And we can see just in Paul's writings, in Galatians 1:11, you abandoned my gospel. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13, Paul's words are God's words. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 8, rejecting Paul's words or rejecting God's words. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, 37, Paul's writings are God's commands. We see that Matthew opens up his gospel with the genealogy. And if you look at the Old Testament, which we believe at the time of Jesus ended with Chronicles, it was just a different order. Same books, but just a different order. If you go to a Jewish synagogue, if you look in the Tanakh or their Jewish Bible, you will look through it and say, oh, well, this is the Old Testament. It's the same books. They're just arranged differently. And they arrange it with Chronicles ending, which has the genealogy in it, which is why Matthew would start with the genealogy, that this is a continuation of that story. Matthew knew he was writing scripture. Paul knew he was writing Scripture. As Peter wrote, Paul knew he was writing Scripture. Peter also likewise knew he was writing Scripture with the authority empowered to them by God. So we can recognize the canonical books by three characteristics. And of course, this comes from Dr. Michael Kruger. We know it by the apostolic origins, that this could be written by an apostle or his companion. So we know that they have companions. We have Luke that was a companion to Paul, Mark that was a companion to Peter. We know that they are connected to the first century, not only because we don't have the original manuscripts, we do have commentaries on those original manuscripts. Those are not scripture, but there are early church rabbis or pastors that they actually wrote commentaries on the original manuscripts, and we can date those fairly closely to the first century. A second part is that it has divine qualities. They have beauty and excellency, they have power and authority, and unity and harmony. Now, if you've had an experience like mine, if you read through the Bible, it was written over so many generations that it wasn't written by one person, but there's no way that a committee could come up with something so perfect, so harmonizing. There is no way. It is a unified story from Genesis to Revelation. And the third component that we know, we recognize the canonical books, is the corporate reception. Right away from the early church, the books that they recognized at the very beginning were the same books that we recognize today. And so that brings us to a fourth. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. Now, just to go back on inspiration, if you're not familiar with inspiration, if you think of the word respiration, they're similar, because the Latin is inspiratus, and I recognize that right away. That's to breathe out. So I had to look up the Greek. The Greek is theopneustos. Help me with that for anyone who's taken Greek. Theopneustos. The Greek term is also the same, to breathe out. This is God breathed. And from the very beginning, how did Adam begin his life? With the breath of God. So our fourth distinctive from Alva Havi, Baptists believe that the faithful grow in grace through Christian experience and discipleship. So back to 16 and 17. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. I heard Ronald Reagan say that the answer to man's problems, all problems, the answers can be found between the covers of the Bible. And I absolutely believe that it does have the answers to our questions. Revelation ends with a warning to heed the information or be condemned. That is an indictment on those who don't believe. If we love people around us, they may be good people, they may do the things that are good for society, they have a good family, they're loving to their friends and family, but if they don't know Jesus, I'm afraid that Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me." He says that I am the good shepherd. Jesus is the good shepherd. Jesus says he is the door. There is only one way to heaven. He said it. I believe it. I trust it, because we can go through the scrutiny. I Tell the Travis Baptist youth they need to have a healthy skepticism in every endeavor that they go on. Go to church. It's good to have questions. God wants you to wrestle with His Word. Jacob wrestled with God and came out a better person. And he was so changed that his name was changed to Israel. Israel is struggles with God. That's Hebrew for struggles with God, Yisrael. God wants you to have a relationship with Him. And the way to do that is through the door with the Good Shepherd. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Speak the truth. Know the truth, because it is in writing. There is no other document that has ever been so scrutinized as the Bible has. And the Bible still exists in the same way. And we get excited about the archaeological finds like the Dead Sea Scrolls, where these documents were buried for 2,000 years, and in 1947 they're discovered, that no one knew that they were there because they had been lost to history, to unroll these scrolls, and it's the exact same texts that we have today. It has gone unchanged. I believe in the inspiration of God, not only for the apostles speaking or to write onto the documents, but those who translated. And as we read in 1 Peter, I believe, and we as Baptists believe in the priesthood of every believer, that you are inspired when you read Scripture. Scripture is trustworthy, and it is there readily available for you. If you have questions, you should have questions. If you have scrutiny, certainly bring that to Travis Baptist Church. Get plugged into a Sunday school class where we expand on these scriptures, where we struggle with God's Word so that we can better understand it. Because when we read through the scripture, what we are doing is we should read it not as, well, I know this person should do this, or this person should do that, or this person needs to hear this message. That's the wrong thing to do. Read through it as a mirror. This is what I need to do. This is the message I need to hear. This is where I need to change in my life. One of the best lessons that I learned in seminary was from Dr. Brian Chappell. He was answering one of the students' questions, and he just said it in passing, but it was a light bulb moment when Dr. Chappell said, the Bible is not a book of information, it's a book of transformation. God transforms us from a selfish, dishonest person to one made. We have already been made in God's image, but we need to grow and be more Christ-like. And although we as Baptists, we do not have creeds in the Baptist church, in the Catholic Church, they do have the Apostles' Creed, they have the Nicene Creed, the Chalcedonian Creed, and other creeds like that. These are just statements of beliefs, but we do have the Baptist faith and message. And the Travis Baptist Church, they favor the 1963 Baptist faith and message. And the very first thing, section one, discusses Scripture. Okay, here we go. From the Baptist Faith and Message in 1963, section 1. The Holy Bible was written by men, divinely inspired, and is the record of God's revelation of Himself to man. It is a perfect treasure of divine instruction. It has God for its author, salvation for its end, and truth, without any mixture of error, for its matter. It reveals the principles by which God judges us, and therefore is and will remain to the end of the world the true center of Christian union and the supreme standard by which all human conduct, creeds, and religious opinions should be tried. The criterion by which the Bible is to be interpreted is Jesus Christ. That is your Baptist faith and message, 1963. So I hope that you take this message and you really understand that the scripture is a gift from God, that this is something that blesses your life and will bless those around you. And I was just before I turned 40. I was almost 40 years old before I read the Bible from cover to cover. But it really changed me. It really transformed me. I am such a better person for that. I then have read it a couple of times since. I'm endeavoring on my fourth reading through it. It is such I keep finding all kinds of new things, and it is a wonderful treasure. If you're not able to read through it, if you have commitments that prevent you from doing the reading from cover to cover, my suggestion is do the individual books. Like with this message in 2 Timothy, it's not long. I read the whole thing just to prepare for this message today. It takes maybe 10 minutes. There's four chapters. There's books that are even smaller than that. Take these books. Don't just do a devotional where you study an individual couple of sentences, take in a couple of verses. Do the whole book. Look at the context of those verses. Understand what the author intended to send as a message. And that's the best devotional. You know, those devotionals people publish where they explain, I think those are valuable, you should use those, but understand what they're sharing is not, it's not scripture. You should do that as a supplement to reading the whole book. And so take this message. I hope you'll just take 10 minutes this afternoon even and read through 2 Timothy and see what God said, because he didn't mean it just for Timothy, but for us as a church. It's trustworthy and it's valuable. So I do want to invite you to join Travis Baptist Church if you are not a member. I do want to invite you to know Jesus. For those of you who have never accepted Jesus into your life, now would be a good time to come forward and let it be known that you want to accept Jesus into your life and become a better Christ-like person. If you want to transfer your membership to Travis Baptist Church, now is the time to come forward. And we are asking that anyone who has any kind of a prayer concern, that you can come forward at this time. So we'll do our hymn of invitation, which we have. As we sing, go ahead and for those who are interested, please come forward as we sing. Just as I am. Let's stand, please. Thank you for coming to Travis Baptist Church today. We do have For anyone that has youth, middle and high schoolers, we do meet in the youth room on Sunday evenings. Tonight we're going to have a game night. We're going to be cracking some codes to save the world. It is a lot of fun, and we do have some food available. So anyone who knows a young person that needs to get plugged into a good youth group, we have one here at Travis Baptist Church. And now we have Ralph Cariaga doing the dismissal prayer.
Let us pray. Most gracious and heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord, for this marvelous day you've given us, Lord, to be able to be in your house, Lord, because we know throughout this world there's places that can't gather like we do, Lord, and honor and glorify your name. Lord, I ask that you be with our pastor wherever he may be, keep him and his family safe and return him back to us, Lord. Lord, we ask for those that couldn't be here today, Lord, that they know that our prayers are with them wherever they may be. And Lord, you know, there's so much going on in this country today, Lord. And Lord, let's hope that they come to the reality that you still are the focus of our lives and everything that happens is through you, Lord. Lord, thank you for so many blessings that you've bestowed on us through this past week. And be with us as we go our separate ways, Lord, but we never leave you behind, Lord. You're always in our hearts wherever we may be. Lord, thank you for loving us and forgive us when we fail you. For these things we ask in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.